you've heard, but today I will present you this project that I'm working on with Leonie Huddy and Kirsten Davis at Stony Brook. It's about nationalism, patriotism, and support for the European Union. Well, nationalism, very well-known thing. I mean, of course, it's on the rise. Of course, it's a thing, right? I mean, these four people here testify this, right? Are the best evidence for this. Who are these people? My students here, anyone wants to guess? The first person here with the British flag? Anyone? Come on, guys. Nigel Farage, okay? This guy, sono un populista, I'm a populist. He's very upfront with it, right? That's Matteo Salvini from Italy. Our own, populist guy. This person, Asylchaos stoppen, right, Helmut? That's Frauke Petri in German, alternative for German. And this person, Ballarat, is pretty prominent right now, right? Marine Le Pen, right? So if we look at this, we would say, wow, yeah, nationalism, populism, sure enough, it must be the thing, right? So you'd imagine nationalism is really, really, really on the rise. So what questions come to mind when we think about this? I have listed a bunch of them. So first, did nationalism rise in Europe over the past two decades? And I want to conduct a short poll. How many people say it rose? It rose a lot, actually. It rose a lot. It rose a lot. Okay. How many people say it rose a little bit? Stable? Defined? Okay, I mean, we have the various
age.
We look at data, overall data, but, let's see. So that's question number one. We'll go back to it, so stay there, hold on. Second, what role does nationalism play in the growing Euroscepticism? Growing Euroscepticism, for sure. I mean, those four guys testify this, right? Then, what role do Eurosceptic right-wing parties play in determining EU support? These are the three questions I try to answer in this short presentation. Okay. But first, before we answer these questions, that I hope are important enough for you guys to consider, let's clarify a few terms. First of all, what is nationalism really? We talked about nationalism being on the rise, nationalism being maybe flying, stable, who knows? But what is it really? We could just summarize this with this sentence here. My country is just better than yours. Yes, it is certainly, love for your country, but it's in a way that basically says, I'm better than you in certain respects, okay? What about this? What are these flowers, sunflowers, seeing here? Wow, I'm so glad I was wearing this talk and not that talk. Okay? And many people confuse it with patriotism, say that this is patriotism, but this is actually not patriotism. This is nationalism. So this is just another way to reiterate the concept. Okay? What do you mean by nationalism? Patriotism is just I love my country. And we don't have anything to say about, oh, my country's better than yours, et cetera, et cetera. So this distinction should be clear. So when we talk about, is nationalism on the rise or no, we talk about nationalism, right? Not patriotism. That's different. And I think it's quite important to underscore the fact that Marine Le Pen, last Sunday, she said, I thank my patriots, the French patriots, right? She was basically implying that if you vote for her, you'd be a good patriot. However, we do know that what Marine Le Pen's ideology is, it's not, and her rhetoric is not, I love my country. Not at all. It's this kind of rhetoric, okay? So I think at least there should be consensus about this. I don't think it's an alternative fact, right? I think that really, this is what Marine Le Pen is saying, and what many, many party leaders are saying across Europe, okay? Anyway, so this is just to set the things up. So data, we have some data to evaluate our statements, to look at our hypotheses, to answer our questions. So we use the International Social Survey Program National Identity Module, and we use the waves of 1995, 2003, and 2013 in particular. We have only these waves, which the ISSP has asked the National Identity Module. So we can basically evaluate over this 20-year time period what happened to nationalism. We have national representative samples here. We have a lot of new countries. The countries that we find in all three waves are a subset of them, but we have nice variation in the sense that we have both Eastern European countries and West European countries, both countries in the north of the Eurozone and in the south of the Eurozone. For instance, you recall Spain is a country that definitely suffered a lot from the Eurozone crisis, right? Germany, on the contrary, is one of the countries that was able to do much better than others in the Eurozone. So we have a lot of stuff. Great, 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 then what? In Brexit, that's interesting that we have that, right? Et cetera, et cetera. I mean, Latvia, Eastern Bloc, so that's very good, right, for variation. So, but let's really look at the data here. So, this is basically just to give you an idea of what nationalism does compared to national pride, for instance, to patriotism. Well, there is generally a positive relationship across all these countries, is all our countries in the center, between nationalism and anti-immigrant sentiment, okay? So this is something to consider. But look now at national pride and anti-immigrant sentiment. Generally, we see a negative relationship, okay? So this is just to reinforce the concept that nationalism and patriotism are different things, okay? And they produce different outcomes in terms of political attitudes. So this is, again, just the first part to make sure that we are on the same page in terms of concepts. And sure enough, there is individual country variation. So within each country, obviously in some countries this relationship is more marked, in other countries it's less so, but so. Let's try to answer the million-dollar question. So, no, we shouldn't have a prize here for our people who said, I don't know. We see the answer. Well, I'm very sorry, guys, but nationalism is remarkably stable and remained just the same pretty much between 95 and 2013. So this is something that, you know, should make us think. To be honest, my colleagues and I were a bit surprised. When we came into this, we thought, well, of course nationalism rose between 95 and 2013. And yet, not at all. All the rest is just the same. If you look at pride, same ethnic national meaning, civic national meaning, how close do you feel to your nation? I mean, all these things remain pretty stable. But particularly, I would like you to focus here on nationalism, okay? So then what's going on? Because your skepticism is on the rise. I mean, we just have to look at the election results. But the core issue of nationalism that, you know, has not changed. So we answer this question, but we're not satisfied, of course. So then we want to look at the role of parties in all this, and the role of nationalism, in particular the interplay between nationalism and parties. Because the idea is, what the heck? Nationalism is stable, and yet we have all these parties, and we have all these growing Euroscepticism. Okay? So now we're trying to really say something about this, and have a very simple message. So here, in this graph, I'm showing you the effect of nationalism on new opposition. breaking the results down by countries that have, that do have an anti-EU party and do not have an anti-EU party. So the line at the top shows you basically the case of countries that do have an anti-EU party, and the line at the bottom shows the case where a country does not have an anti-EU party. So we do see that all else being equal, so keeping constant your level of nationalism, being in a country that has an anti-EU party does make you more Eurosceptic. This is the big message. Okay? And look at pride. National pride. I love my country. So this is my country is better than yours. And this is I love my country. Right? And we do see exactly, basically the opposite. So in the sense that we do see the negative relationship, right? And we still do see, however, that having the anti-EU party in the country still makes you, still is correlated with you being more Eurosceptic, right? But we see that, you know, the slope is exactly the opposite as before. So basically, what is the big message? Nationalism was stable over the past 20 years, at least in our national representative ISSP data. But parties play a big role. So this is the what we attempt to identify as the culprit or the hero in the story. No, depending on which side you're in, right? Political rhetoric, okay? That's basically the magic bullet that that anti-EU political parties throw into the political arena. So this is, I think, a good place to think about some implications of this. But before we do this, let's sum up the conclusions. Nationalism remains stable, again, between 1995 and 2013. And Eurosceptic nationalistic right-wing parties seem to make a difference to determine declining EU support. And a possible answer, then, is anti-EU political rhetoric. And I'll tell you also that education does play a role as well. So in particular, the interplay between nationalism, a political party which is Eurosceptic in the country, and education level determines significantly what your position on the, you know, on Europe and on European integration would be. So that implication really, and the thing that I would like you to consider today, is the following. Is the European Union losing the political rhetoric battle? Because we do see that when you have an anti-EU party there, regardless of how many votes they got, regardless of how extreme they have, but just having that voice, that amplified voice, makes people more Eurosceptic of the EU. So I happen to have a little bit of experience with, you know, European Union institutions, and I have to say, my biggest complaint is usually the one about fighting this battle. My personal opinion, and this is not in the data, is that the European Union is not even playing this battle, okay? It's a soccer game where 11 people are on the field and the other team doesn't show up, okay? We are losing this game. We are losing this game really, really badly, just because we're not playing it, okay? So that's my take on this. If I may give you just a little anecdote, I worked with Mario Monti on the proposed reform of the budget of the European Union, in particular of the way the European Union finances itself. And I can tell you, it's the first time in the history of the European Union that our group has tried to think about even these questions, about how people might perceive, say, new taxes, you know, say, okay, let's introduce a new financial transaction tax. fantastic. How will the Brits react? Now there's no Brits. How will the Germans react? How will the Italians react now that, you know, the Brits are out and maybe, you know, Wall Street, the European Wall Street can go to Milan, right? That was the idea. So how will Italy react to financial transaction? So it's the first time that really have thought about this, but still there is a lot that we do not know. Okay? So in my experience, you know, this is the fight that we have to enter, the game that we have to play if we want to reverse a bit the course of the situation. So I hope, again, that these data are telling to you and really shed light on something that maybe surprised you a bit. I leave you with this so that my next our colleague can have enough time for his presentation. If you have any questions, just email me or email.